What's up, everybody? And this is your boy Retro Rogue. I am back and I'm here with my boy John. Off camera, my roommate Huey. We are about to take a voyage into space, into outer space. Check it out, Rebel Moon. Now, I will be straight up and tell you, I've seen this. I've already watched it. My buddy John here has not seen it at all, didn't know nothing about it, just watched the trailer for it a few minutes ago. And we're going to watch it, and then we're going to come back and we're going to review it. I was thinking about doing it as a reaction, but since I've seen it, I've decided we're just going to watch it, enjoy it, and then we'll come back, review it. And at the end of the review, we're going to do a reaction to Rebel Moon Part 2, Scargiver. So we will see you guys on the flip. Catch you in a minute. Here we go. Rebel Moon. It's going to be a good one.
Yeah, excited, man.
All right.
This is the dawn of something better.
What's up, everybody? We are back. Woo, that was a hell of a flick, man. It's like my third time watching it. Your first time watching it, I didn't ask him at all. I waited until we started recording again, so I'm going to ask you now.
Yeah.
What'd you think?
There's a lot. There's a lot to put into just a couple simple words, but I will say that Rebel Moon, it can be a start of a good franchise.
Oh, yeah.
I think what Zack Snyder was supposed to do, he did it well for the first part. I'm excited to see what second part comes in. And I have a lot of parts of the movie where I had questions. It drew me into the movie. I wanted to make sure that I understand exactly who these people were, because they just drop you in the movie right off the bat. You don't know anything. And you have to pick up the pace as they're presenting everyone. So I love these characters so far. I think they're pretty awesome. General Titus.
Oh, dude. Like, first off, hats off to this brother. He got swole for this role.
Bro.
I can't wait to see him do something.
Yeah, he didn't do anything.
He didn't do shit. He get talking to him. He get talking. Cora, man. Arthur Dayes, or however you say her real name. But I'm just going to keep calling her Cora because it's an easier name to say.
Yeah, for sure.
Man, she's our main protagonist. What do you think of her?
I, at first, was kind of like, who is this chick? Because at first, when she's like a farm girl, I was like, okay, who is this? Why is she smelling dirt?
That's literally the first question he asked. He said, bro, why is she smelling the dirt? I was like, it's a farmer thing, man. It's a country thing. It smells good.
Yeah, I mean, I was just like kind of worried because she was very, always a little bit over the edge. Like, she seemed like she was worried all the time. She was kind of like scared. I'm like, if she's going to be the main protagonist, I want her to be badass. Where there are strong female characters out there, like shout out to Sigourney Weaver, for sure. But I just wanted to make sure that she doesn't be portrayed as like a scared individual. But as I started learning more about her, her story, and how she was like high regard, she was like the bodyguard of the princess.
Yeah.
She is just this badass commander at 18 years old. I was like, I really enjoyed her. And I see why she's so worried, because she knows who these space Nazis are.
Space Nazis. That's what they are, man. Space Nazis. But I think what killed me was her transformation from the first 30, 40 minutes of the film when she's on there just doing her farm thing. And not even 30, 40 minutes, like 20, 30 minutes into the film. And, you know, you can tell she's kind of withdrawn from everybody and stuff. She's just doing her work and stuff. But, you know, she's still feminine. And you can tell that she still has wants, and she doesn't deny who she is, not from the get. Like, even before all the badassery starts, you know, she explains, she's like, I'm a child of war, you know, I've been through a lot. You know, she's like, love and family, like, those concepts were beat out of her at an early age. But she still seemed very feminine to me. And then when the shit finally hit the fan and my girls finally decided to take action, and she was like, it's like her body woke up or something. Like, and I'm laughing like the whole time I'm watching this shit, cause like I never saw any kind of muscular definition from her. She looked like a fit person, but she didn't look like she was in the gym every day. She looked like she didn't have what I would consider a soldier's body.
Right.
But the moment it was time to get down, and she like it was like her.
She was there.
It just woke up, and suddenly there's definition where it was. And I was like, damn. I was like, is she wreck shop, man? What the young dude say now? She's standing on business art.
Yeah.
She's standing on all the business, like.
Yeah, that whole sequence in the barn where, you know, she prevented that whole situation with the girl.
Yeah.
The girl that was serving water and stuff. But I really liked how she was able to take out like 3 or 4 soldiers by herself.
Just.
Yeah, easily, you know, with an axe, and then she just got the rifle, and then it was just her by herself. I really hope they bring old boy, the kid that you said, the soldier.
Yeah, I hope he's back in the next one, because that kid, dude, I fell in love with him immediately, too, just because when I first saw him, I chalked him off as, oh, he's going to be the little nerdy soldier kid that shouldn't be here, and they're going to beat him all, and like... But no, this kid had all the heart. Like, he had all the heart. No quit in him. I love the technology in this world has been crazy as hell. The weaponry and stuff. But I think one of my favorite pieces, though, was Sir Anthony Hopkins' android, the Jimmy.
The Jimmy, yeah.
Like, he just, first off, applause to the FX crew. Because
it's amazing.
He looks so real. Like it was like I felt like I was looking at a real person talking. Like and I don't mean that like as like a real person in the sense of I didn't think it looked fake. I mean the android. If I was sitting next to that android, it would have felt like he wasn't an android. That he was a living, breathing person.
Yeah, well, even like the fact where he's talking to the girl again, the same girl where she just touches his face and it lights up.
Like he blushed.
He blushed and then he touched his face like, did you feel that?
Right.
Like, what?
Oh, well, he's washing the mud off of him and he's like, and it looks like a dude who's just...
It felt natural.
And he, my man even wrings his hands. Yeah. I'm just like...
Yeah, he does.
But it just... The fluid of movement, I think, is what it is. It was not choppy. It didn't feel like he was a robot.
No, not at all.
And when he spoke, like, when we speak, our heads do certain things. And when he was speaking, his head was doing those things.
Yep, like tilting. He was, like, going and nodding and stuff like that. But even speaking of Jimmy, I was really shocked to the point where I wanted to see the android more in the film.
Yeah.
I was kind of upset where he kind of, like, ran off after the fight of the barn. I got shocked because he holds the rifle, and the guy is saying like
he's holding his sideways.
He's like, kill him. He's like, kill him, because you know the bad guy is like holding the girl at a good point, and he just holds the rifle, not even holding it well, and all of a sudden he just turns and he just shoots, hits him straight in the face, and he just drops it and runs away. And I'm like,
but they do explain though, like when the king was killed, him and his brothers literally stopped fighting. Like, they just stopped. And it's so funny because from the, like, my boy takes point blank range shots from one of these plasma rifles, like 3 good shots, and doesn't even dent his freaking exoskeletal armor. Like, he just knocks him in the dirt and gets him muddy.
Yeah. I really hope that they don't nerf him in the second part.
Yeah, because he's clearly, like, tank. You understand why these guys were the King's Royal Guard. I couldn't imagine an army of them up. Man.
Like, no wonder he was the king for a long time.
My dude was standing sideways, gun held sideways. He just straight head shots. Get down! Like, it was nothing. And then he just drops in it. Like, oops, shit.
Yeah. Yeah, I really hope that they can show more of him in the part 2 because, and I don't want them to be him like sacrificing himself or anything, because I think he can really do a lot of damage, and I think they need technology like him.
Oh yeah, because he's gonna be invaluable to the upcoming fight because you know it's coming. I also enjoyed the prince that they had to go get out of servitude, who is clearly a native allegory. I think just from the way he is built and designed, the fact that he had to tame a griffin. pretty cool. Like how he was, you know, he was really like one with the animal, and I'm calling it a griffin. They have a name for it in the movie. It's a griffin.
It's a griffin, bro.
It's a griffin, man. It, like, let's be real. It's what it is.
Yeah.
But I love that. I know, as someone who has been around horses most of my life and have helped break horses and train horses, like when you have a animal that is difficult to break, the person who initially is able to tame it is going to be the one working with it for a very long time, especially before anyone else is going to be trying to get on it.
Yeah.
And this guy seemed to know his business, so I don't understand why he thought
he could just hop
on it after dude rode it once, and the griffin did not make it easy for my dude. He earned that ride.
Yeah,
he earned the respect of that griffin. But yeah, I like just how all of them came together. Was very interesting. It made sense for the story.
Yep.
And the twist, really, I'm trying not to be spoilery about it, but it's been out for like almost a month at this point.
Yeah.
So, not a month, December 22nd, so a couple of weeks. It's been out for a few weeks. So, like, I'm trying not to be spoilery, but let's be real, It was a twist that I can honestly say I just didn't see coming, mostly because I really liked the character. I was like,
yeah,
son of a bitch. I was like, you got me. That's been a long time since a show I didn't see the betrayal coming. And then, since I've gone back and rewatched it,
yeah,
I was like, oh, it was all there.
He just, you know, he said it straight out.
Yeah, at one point in time, he literally tells it, like,
I'm not honorable.
I'm not an honorable person. I'm not a trustworthy individual.
Well.
But and then right at the end, right before it all happened, like, there was all these clues. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, shit.
Well, like, he even said, like, the guy who was talking to the one that, you know, when they docked, he was like, what do you want then?
Yeah.
Like, I was like, what, cargo.
That dude was the bounty hunter that caught old boy that, you know, they...
Oh, I didn't realize
that. Oh, yeah, that was the same Cuddy. And also, when he was like, don't look in the boxes, I wouldn't want you to think less of me. I was like, I was like, there's so many red flags that went up, and I called him so late. But so did she. By the time she realized what was going on, it was too late too.
Yeah.
But he does get his, and I like that. That whole last fight sequence was incredible. I love how everybody was doing their part. The general was just off in the corner somewhere.
The general just appeared out of nowhere. I was like, is he drinking? Like, where do you get this thing?
Yeah, he went and found him some alcohol. And then when it was all said and done, he was like, this is a decisive blow.
Like, yeah, we did this.
I'm like, did we though?
And then he has a pause and he's like, we're getting paid, right?
We're getting paid.
I was like, okay, man.
Like, my dude, man.
I will say two things. Like, one, like you were saying, the ending, like there was a twist where I kind of even compared it to a little bit of like the Miraculous Seven or like the Seven Samurai, if like you've ever seen like the Seven of like anime, where I expected that type of storyline. I was like, you know, they're protecting the village, whatever the case may be. But then they really do a really good pivot where you're just like, oh, well, I like this ending. I really do. And that can even segue it into what is going to happen in part two, right? So that's number one. Second, I think the farmer boy needs more credit because in the whole movie, I think he was kind of like a little wimp.
But dude, he got the father killed. The father is the title of the leader of the village. Like but at the same time, the father and him both fucked up because they didn't listen to her.
Mm-hmm.
She told them, give them what they want. Don't offer anything else. Don't offer any information. Just give them whatever they ask for. Let them leave. And hope they don't dig into anything further.
Yep.
The father couldn't even do that.
Nah,
he immediately was just trying to fucking keep from giving him anything. And I'm just like, my dude. And then old boy, who should have just genuinely either just backed
his father,
his leader's play,
yeah,
or just kept his mouth shut.
Yeah.
But no, he threw my dude under the bus. Cause he tried to be slick. He tried to
make some coin.
Yeah. He thought he could reason with these people after, again, you know, someone who has dealt with them before tried to explain that he cannot reason with these guys. They don't, there's no reason that they are going to take everything we have. Just, and so a lot of that to me played into their ignorance. You know what I'm saying? Because even after it happened, they were still like, well, we work hard to show them, you know, that we're useful. It's like they were still on this mindset of we can reason with them.
And they just saw what they did to the leader.
Yeah. And so, like, a lot of it, I think, came from just the ignorance of, it was very clear through action. You didn't have to give us exposition or story. You, just from what we saw, it was very clear that this colony on this world had never really dealt with the mother world and their military forces before. They probably, just because they were too small, just clearly not on the radar.
Yep.
What got them on the radar was old boy selling grain
to, like, the rebel.
To the rebel.
Rebel.
Rebels. Rebel.
Rebel.
They make it very clear not to use that S.
No.
But that's what got their village on the radar in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just, it was rough to watch. But, you know, it is, like I said, though, it's a very Seven Samurai, Magnificent Seven, you know, ragtag group of people coming together to protect the town. Very common trope, very, very, very good fucking story line if it's done right. I'm glad to know that, you know, he's like, I can't do this in one film, we're going to do it in two.
Which is cool.
Yeah, so the second one is coming out in April, which is awesome, and of course, Zack Snyder being Zack Snyder, there's a rumor going around that he has a full-on rated R version of this, and I want to see that.
I do
want to
see that.
With the fight sequences and shit in this, yes, because there are some people get holes blown in them, man. I want to see some blood and guts, dude.
Yeah.
Some people get sliced and diced and everything nice, and I want to see some rated R version of that. I understand where a lot of folks are like, this movie has a Star Wars problem. I don't think it has a Star Wars problem. I think Star Wars fans have a problem with this film.
Yeah, well, I think, like, Rebel Moon is its own thing.
It is very much its own thing. Is it taking tropes from other existing things? Sure.
Yeah.
But so did Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
So did Star Trek. So did everything else under the sun. So did Harry Potter. So did Percy Jackson. So did Fast and the Furious. So you know, it's like, again, I say it all the time. There are seven story types that exist in the world. Just seven. And every other version, every other story type is a variation of one of the original seven story types.
Right.
So, but, you know, all we can do is pick one of those story types and tell it, hopefully, in a unique and interesting way. And I think this is unique, and I think it's a very interesting way to tell a space opera type story. And I don't remember if I've ever seen a Seven Samurais, Magnificent Seven.
In space.
I don't think I've ever seen anything like that. So, I think we got close with Boba Fett. Kinda.
When they got everyone together?
Yeah. That was an episode. It wasn't the heart of the show.
It wasn't intended. It just happened.
Yeah. So, but again, that really wasn't in space. Like, it was just on a planet. These motherfuckers go all over the place. So much so that I was just like, what? Like, I can't do it. I can't travel in space like that. I just don't, especially their ships. They first off, they just look like big. Let's discuss real quick. Yeah. How they travel through space.
Oh, dude. The first thing that they show you, I'm just like, is that? Come on.
That's clearly a giant vajayjay that's being ripped into space. And the ships are penal shaped.
I'm like, who are these writers, man? Like,
oh, God. I was like, man, somebody knew what they were doing. Dude, they knew what they were doing. Like, they knew what they were doing. I feel like they did. I was like, I'll see if I can notice this. Yeah, bro, we noticed. We absolutely noticed. I want you to know that. But all in all, great film. Super excited for part two. Speaking of part two, before we let my homie go, we're going to watch the trailer for Rebel Moon Part 2, The Scargiver, which is Korra's nickname. Which is again, and when you like, she pretty much tells you her story. But when you find out that like she is wanted, like she like, there's a sequence at the very end where the general, who is her like adopted father, he, first off, I respect this villain. I respect any villain who does not underestimate the people he is going up against.
Yeah.
And the language he uses is.
Well, he's very much a true tactician.
Yeah. Because
he's not underestimating no one.
Yeah, he's looking at his underlings like, why do you think, like, dude's like, yeah, we found him. She's with this nigga and this nigga. He's like, did you think this is good news?
Like, this is not
he's nice. Like, so you're telling me the most powerful, badass soldier that we've ever created
is teamed up with
the genius general.
Titus.
With a group of would-be insurgents.
I don't see where it's good news, man.
he's like, you are overestimating your ability and underestimating theirs. Like, I respect any dude that understands the gravity of the situation. He's told old boy flat out, I don't think you appreciate how serious this situation is, because you're either gonna get this done or you're gonna be the motherfucker that I make a public spectacle of.
Yeah.
Like, it's that serious. And like, so they are making it very clear. They've made it very clear how badass and dangerous the people in this little franchise is. I think people are sleeping on my boy Jimmy. I think they sleeping on him hard. I think he's gonna show to be just, he is not R2-D2, mm-hmm. He is not C-3PO,
nope.
He's not even K-2SO, who was a badass, all
right? Right, right. I think he's gonna be playing a bigger part in this one. I think either him or the what's it called, the army is gonna bring their own Jimmies, and they're gonna be
trying but here's the thing. I don't think the Jimmies are gonna fight for them, like, because they won't. Like, that's their story. It's like the moment they found out their king was dead, they just laid down arms and just refused to fight.
Well,
they do manual labor type shit. I think if they do introduce more Jimmies, I think he'll be the one who like, we have somebody to fight for or whatever.
Like, oh, like he's gonna get them to fight with them.
Yeah. He'll rally them against the Mother World, which we still don't know much about the Mother World. I don't think it's Earth. I think this is another faraway galaxy kind of thing. You know, this is their own universe or their own galaxy and shit. So
I really do want to see the Mother World, because we saw like
we got little glimpses of it through the little vajayjay hole.
Or like in the virtual aspect when you saw like
the tree line in the background and stuff.
I mean, I'm pretty excited. I really want to see what it shows in like part two of the trailer or the teaser. Hopefully this really doesn't like fall flat, because I think Jack Snyder is coming onto something. I think that it's not going to be a Star Wars killer. But
no, not only Star Wars, it has been around for way too long. I'm not worried about that for that. But it could be a new... We haven't had a really great sci-fi franchise to latch on to since Battlestar Galactica.
Yeah.
And it was so short-lived. So I'm really looking forward. And we haven't had a long stay franchise, sci-fi franchise, since Star Wars and Star Trek. Mm-hmm. Which they, you know, they holding it down. They the big, you know, when you talk about the big three of sci-fi, that's going to be your big three. It's going to be Star Trek, Star Wars, Battlestar Galactica. Yeah. There's room for Doctor Who or Red Dwarf, but let's be real, it's Battlestar Galactica. But yeah, so. Without further ado, we're hopping into this right now. This is Rebel Moon, Part 10, The Scargiver. Let's check it. I hear you whining, hush. Let's check this out. Told you, they like, oh, we don't have to fight. That shit wasn't over, my dude.
Their nightmare is us. Fighting together to defend something we love.
You must know you cannot win.
Gather every hunting rifle, every knife, every round of ammunition in the village.
That's impressive.
Time has come for all that you love. Show them no mercy.
You stand between us and annihilation.
Tell me what we're trying to achieve here.
The same thing as the last time we met. I kill you.
And she seemed very content on killing him again. She said, I'm just going to kill you again. That's, you know, another Tuesday here on the planet.
Yeah.
She cut her hair. She went back to that military haircut.
I don't know if I like it.
I get the significance of it. She's like, I've got to be a soldier again, so I got to get back into that soldier mode. I think, though, she should have worn a different cut. I just don't think that cut works for her. But, you know, it's not supposed to. It's not supposed to be attractive, I guess.
It's supposed to be efficient.
Yes. You know, tactical, even. But, that looked good. Visually, again, just... I
expected a little bit more of Jimmy. I just saw him a little bit just landing in superhero land.
It is a teaser.
Okay.
It is a teaser. So, which means we're going to get a real trailer. Okay. Probably within a month. I say they'll probably drop the next... The official trailer will probably drop probably around late February, early March. That's when we'll get the first official real trailer. We'll probably get two good trailers. You know, Netflix, then they'll do their little featurettes and all that stuff. I try to avoid that shit because I want to be surprised when I watch stuff. I really wish I would have watched. I wish this would have been in theaters here in Phoenix. It was not. It was in select theaters when it first came out. But, so we had to watch it when it came out on Netflix, but I would have loved to have watched it on the big screen, man.
I don't see why wouldn't it be in the theaters. I think it's a pretty good movie.
Yeah, it's great. It's great. If part two gets to be in Phoenix, I'm definitely going to check it out. Because I think they are going to do select viewings again, or select viewings. So that will be something I'm definitely going to check out. But all in all, I think, I agree with you. I think this has absolutely great potential.
Yes.
To be a franchise that people could get into. I'm already looking forward to seeing the cosplay. for this is going to be insane to look at, man. Especially Sister Girl with them damn...
Those, not lightsabers.
Okay. Not lightsabers.
Energy blades.
Yeah. But, yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing where this goes. We're going to hop off here, guys, so we can get this man to his family. Be looking out for my boy here in the future. Try to put together something here on the channel where we do more reviews and talk about movies, anime, shows, and whatnot. Just all things geeky. Try to get him and try to get my brother involved, but he's all the way in Kentucky, so we're gonna try to do it up video linking. He's smarter than me when it comes to that stuff, so he'll be helping me with that. But as soon as we get a format set up for that, we'll be putting it out there for everybody to see. That being said, I'm gonna hop off here, man. The boy Retro Rogue.
Here's Lace. How's it going, man?
Peace out. Remember, it's the age of the geek.
We rule the world.
Peace.